Hi everyone, welcome to ELI, the place where you get your daily dose of inspiration for entrepreneurship. And today we have with us Mr. Rishi Das, the co-founder of IndieCube, which is a workspace provider for large and small enterprises. Rishi is a graduate of IIT Roorkee and has been an entrepreneur for last 20 plus years, co-founding multiple ventures along the way. Hi Rishi, welcome to ELI.
Hi Priyaranjan. Hi, thank you.
I would request you to introduce yourself to our audience, please.
Yeah, hi everyone. And I'm assuming a large part of us listening to this podcast would be entrepreneurs or people aspiring or already entrepreneurs. So I belong to Lucknow, came and then did my engineering, as Priyaranjan mentioned, from IIT Roorkee 1997. And then decided to have a brief stint in IT, worked for a company called Tata Infotech for briefly about a year. And then in 1998, decided to go entrepreneur. Those were different days of entrepreneurship, unlike today, where entrepreneurship is a lot more fashionable. So along with my brother, co-founded CareerNet. It's a company into the recruitment space, right? From campus hiring to senior level hires is what we manage. So we are perhaps the largest recruitment company in India, and we have a team of about 2,200 people now. And these are all recruiters. We don't do any temping in that business. So we manage the entire spectrum of recruiting from campus to boardroom, and then also across all aspects of hiring is what we do in that company. And a large part of my entrepreneurial journey has been CareerNet. And in 2015, along with my other co-founder, Meghna, started IndieCube. And that's a company into the managed office spaces, where we provide office spaces to a lot of startups, late stage companies, even Fortune 500 companies. And there we manage about 3.5 million square feet of office space now, spread across 6 cities. And yeah, so that's what has been my journey so far. So large part of my journey has been as an entrepreneur. And on the way, I've invested in few companies as an angel investor or as a strategic investor. So that's another thing I've been doing on the sidelines, yeah.
Okay. So we will take a moment to discuss about your latest venture, IndieCube. Tell us what is it about in a detailed way, what are the different offerings we have and the scale of operations?
So let me give a background why we started IndieCube. So basically, for CareerNet, we were growing very, very fast, and every 2 years we were changing office. So we were fed up with that. And then we said, why don't we take up a larger office space and give the remaining space to other companies so that when we grow, we don't have to change office. So with that intent, we moved into a 100,000 square feet office in Bangalore, where our requirement was only 50,000 square feet. And this was in 2013. Then whatever companies we gave the office space, these companies started asking that, can I use your boardroom once a month, training room up twice a month, transport, food, whatever amenities, services we created for our own use, they wanted to leverage that. So that is when we realized that there is a big gap in the market. At one end, you have the tech parks and the UBCity kind of buildings. And then you have individual landlords. So the market was very, very polarized towards five-star and then no brand kind of a situation. So we thought that why don't we create an affordable office space brand in the market, which is a lot more accessible from a price point, from a location perspective, and which provides a plethora of services. Because at the end of the day, office is a lot about B2B and B2C services. So with that intent, we picked up one property of 150,000 square feet in 2015, and it clicked. Within 4 or 5 months, the whole space was leased out to different companies. So that gave us a lot of confidence that we have hit something big. So at that point of time, Meghna, my other co-founder, was focusing full time on this along with my father. And then over a period of time, I started weaning off operationally from CareerNet and got involved into this full time. So today, as I talk to you, we are present in 6 locations across India, all 6 major cities. We have 50 plus properties, and we have an area of about 3.5 million square feet that we manage, which is spread across 70,000 seats. Mm-hmm. And we have 400 plus enterprise clients. One thing which differentiates us from other co-working operators has been that a large part of our focus is on enterprises. So typically you see 95% of our business comes from companies which have taken 50 seats going up to say 5,000 seats. So that's the bulk of business. So and these are mostly large size, long stay companies which have been with us. And most of these companies have a mind of their own. So they require personalized offices. They expect to be in their own office rather than in somebody else's office. So for their culture, brand, everything becomes very important. And also India is a very price conscious market. So people definitely expect different price points. So not everybody can afford a 20 rupee cup chai coffee. So we have chai coffee accessible at 5 rupees a cup going up to 20 rupees. So people can choose a lot of services in terms of scope and pricing depending upon their requirements. So and this whole thing runs on a good technology platform. The advantage we have is coming from technology background. We leverage a lot of that. So each tenant or client we have is treated like a multi-tenancy setup on the platform. And a plethora of B2B and B2C services are available to him or her on a la carte or outcome-based pricing model. So, yeah.
The co-working space model has been in a lot of debate recently due to the WeWork WeWork's valuation drop that happened, I think, 2 years back. And after that, the impact was also felt in many of the Indian workspace companies. So any major fluctuation or impact that you have faced during that time and even during the COVID time?
So, one thing which distinguishes India from other markets is India is a very large commercial real estate market. If you see Indian commercial real estate, the organized real estate is almost 650 million square feet now. And it is very comparable to US. So to give you an idea, pre-COVID, between 2013 and 18, Bangalore absorbed 55 million square feet of space. And Shanghai was 27 million square feet. So you imagine Bangalore absorbing two times more real estate than Shanghai. I can't think of any other area where we will be double of a large city like China, large Chinese city in anything else. So I think, what India clearly requires or continues to require is a 1.0 in our kind of industry. It is very hard to replicate what may work in a downtown in London, Paris, or any of the big cities, or even in US, and do it here. A large part of Indian commercial real estate is highly unorganized. The public transport is still very, very weak in most of the places. And the price point expectations are very, very different over here. Our kind of country is not looking at a five-star buffet. Our kind of country is looking at more of a 199 pizza with a lot of toppings. And as we are growing as an economy, the minimum price of pizza will go to 249, 299 and like that. So there are a lot of, I will say, country-specific nuances, and the market is so large that we require a 1.0 over here. So basically, while WeWork has been a pioneer and they did a lot of good to the industry because they created a market, a lot of larger companies, and they created an aspiration that this business is about business centers, is a new way of consuming workspaces. So I think they did their bit. Somewhere on the way, basically, they overachieved than what they could swallow. And possibly they ran into troubles. And I am hoping that they will definitely be making a comeback in some way or the other. So that definitely have a dent on that. But since the India growth story was in the commercial real estate, predominantly hinges on IT and the startups. And that segment has done exceptionally well. As you can see, the kind of IPOs raining these days is happening. So with all that happening, I think business is only going to go up. Where COVID came in, COVID was definitely a big bump for all of us because first people started thinking that whether they will come back to office or not. Then it changed to hybrid. And still, if you ask me, nobody knows what percentage of people, when, how, who will come back to office. So, and I believe that this whole thing will take 12 to 24 months to settle down. But in all of this, the best part that has happened is that companies have continued to hire. If you ask today any company, what were their headcount in March 20 and today, 50 to 100% headcount growth has minimum happened in most of these companies.
Okay.
So what we are seeing now is in the last 3 months, as companies have started talking to us again, that a lot of them are saying, okay, even if 50% people come back, 60% people come back, or we require office, we still will require 100% of the space that we were having in March 20. So that's a good part, that there is no shrinkage. And a lot of other things are happening. Like basically, people today definitely know that nobody will commute 2 hours a day to work. So the concept of offices is coming in. Intercity, intracity, talent shortage is acute. So people are now exploring tier two cities in a big way for all of that. So I think any kind of distributed workforce model or any kind of flexibility because of uncertainty which people are requiring, all this is going to fuel our business. And the way we see the managed office co-working business is, I will say, a 2.0 of commercial real estate. See, the way you think of large malls that came in India about 15 years back, right? Before that, we used to have shopping complexes. I think the commercial real estate has reached that tipping point where it is no longer just about the hardware, providing the real estate with some good fountains and stuff like that around it. It is a lot more deeper. It's more closer to hospitality, providing a plethora of B2B and B2C services and all of that. So once we talk about that, we will see that change. And that is where you are seeing that people who own commercial real estate and people who will manage commercial real estate, there is a decoupling happening. And our industry is part of that change. So I think both from a demand and supply point of view, this looks like is the right model to go over the next 8-10 years of consumption. And COVID definitely pushed consolidation, which I think was very much required, because in India, the regulation tends to be very weak. A lot of people operating from properties where there are occupancy certificate issues, compliance issues, and all of that. So it was going on because there was madness. If you see, a Bangalore kind of place was having 97-98% occupancy before COVID. Today, it is hovering around 90-93%. So I think somewhere COVID has helped to differentiate the men and the boys from that perspective. And that was very much required. People are asking those hard questions now, quality, continuity, and all of that, which people were not asking because so much was madness was there. So I believe that good, bad, 5 to 10 good players by geography, pan India, will evolve in India. And we can already see that happening now.
Okay. We can discuss more about venture, but I'd rather spend more time on discussing about your journey as an entrepreneur. Would like to hear about your early days of entrepreneurship, how it all started. Why did you choose the path of entrepreneurship in a time when entrepreneurship was not a cool thing in India? In fact, there was no buzz around it.
Yeah. So for me, if I recollect, since my school days, basically when I was possibly a 10, 12 year old kid, business always used to fascinate me. The way they run, the way they make profits, that was always very fascinating to me. And large part of my family comes from business, even though my father retired from UP State City Board as chief engineer there. But large part of my family was always in business. If I recollect, my big tipping point was the liberalization in 1991. That is where it really caught my attention, typically. And since then, I have been reading Economic Times for last 30 plus years, and other business publications I picked up on the way, and a lot of periodical journals I picked up. And did one startup while I was in class 11, 12. It was into floriculture, helping one of my uncles do that. When I joined IIT Roorkee, there was Science Technology Entrepreneurship Park. So set up the student chapter for that. A new elective in entrepreneurship was floated at that time, immediately grabbed that, topped that elective. So whatever little opportunities as an engineering student I could come on the way, I was very keen to pick them up, all of them. When I joined my first job, the first day I realized that I'm back to, it gave me a feeling of coming back to class first, where you wear a uniform and then go to your school and you suddenly feel that you are lost. So that was a day I realized that I do not have the patience to basically withstand this, do it over years. So that was in a way a put off or a you can say the push that I need to be on my own. Job is not meant for me. Okay. Then worked there for about a year, and then left it one fine day. Basically, my parents thought that I'm back to Lucknow on vacation. Mm. Then after 1 or 2 realized that he's not going back, so he's possibly left the job. So explored a few things here, there, through family, friends, connects, and all of that. And then narrowed down to the idea of starting CareerNet. And why CareerNet? My brother had joined Infosys. Anshuman, my other co-founder, he joined Infosys in 98 from IIT Delhi. Pfizer from IIT Delhi. Okay. So I started the things in Noida. So we were able to compare what was happening in Noida and especially NCR and Bangalore at that time. Hmm. And we it is a good business to get in. There was no naukri.com by that time kind of thing. And even email was a privilege. Mobile calls were 16 rupees a minute kind of pricing point in 97, 98. Hmm. So we thought that, and networking came very naturally to us. We were very active in our alumni groups, 3 batches senior, 3 batches junior kind of folks. So we thought that this is a good area where we come from tech backgrounds. And why don't we build a career out of this? And most importantly, this business does not require any capital. Mm. So we started at PC. PC used to cost 2,500 rupees a month on rent. So started with that and got a lot of success. That was a time when the Y2K problem was at its peak. A lot of body shopping was happening to US. So we were able to place a lot of people in companies there. And from there on, it kept on building. So then my brother earlier was doing moonlighting. Then he left in 99. And then when we went, both went full time. We involved a few of our schoolmates, very close friends, to join us as part of our initial team. And I'm happy that a large part of them are still with us. Our employee number 1, 2, 3 who joined in 99 are still with us. So we, if you see on the CareerNet side, we easily have 50 plus people who have completed 15 years with the company. So that's the kind of culture organization we were able to build and do a completely bootstrapped business. So never took any debt, any equity in that business, CareerNet business, for most part of our journey. Few stock options are held by our employees in that business. Otherwise, by and large, have been able to do that. So, and then IndiCube happened, and IndiCube, as I told you, was more of a opportunity setting on the enterprise edge. It was not as per a business plan or funding and all of that. And once we got into that, 2018, we raised a round of capital from Westbridge because this business requires a much larger amount of capital and right. wanted to grow very fast. So we had to take a lot of risk. So equity capital was required, and we also got lots of support from Ashish Gupta. He was a basically founding partner for Helion. So Ashish, in his personal capacity, put in some amount of money. And he has been a mentor and support to me for last 2 decades. So with that, that's how the entrepreneur journey, the 2.0 shaped up of my journey as an entrepreneur. Yeah.
Okay. So wanted to understand your perspective on what is happening in India since last 5 years, especially a lot of startups coming up, a lot of unicorns coming up, and as well as the funding space is also a little heated up since last 5 years. So what is your perspective? Where is India going and how is the startup story leading the whole narrative?
So I always give the analogy of a nuclear fission reaction when I look at the entrepreneurship story in India. I think the first nuclear fission reaction was in the late 90s when companies like Naukri.com or Infosys and all of them actually came to big limelight. This was the late 90s, early 2000s kind of a time frame. And then we saw the other stint happening in 2008, 2009, 2007, 2008, when the Flipkarts of the world actually started growing. Third was around 2015, when basically a lot of these companies started getting exits. Founders were making smart money. The initial team was making smart money. And a lot of this smart money was going into promoting other entrepreneurs. See, in India, the big problem has been that the Indian businessman has been by and large interest and rent seeking class. If you go to any small town in India and you ask where do you get most of your income from, people will say rent and interest, right? So there was no concept of risk. And I think a lot of that, what has happened, now we are possibly in the fourth stage of nuclear fission reaction. And as you know, nuclear fission reaction, when it reaches the later stages, it just compounds. So I think what we have hit now is basically a massive a chain reaction now. And that is where you see the today, I personally have lost count of the unicorns that have come out in this year. So and I think the next 10 years, this is going to continue. The India story is so robust, so strong, that if any of us as entrepreneurs or would-be entrepreneurs do not capitalize on it, we are only to blame for it. So it is at a phenomenal place. Of course, things seem to be little too heated up. And I just hope that none of this goes the Satyam way. Basically, two bad stories, two busts, definitely earn a lot of bad name for the entire startup world. So I think that's one place where we all need to be very cautious and act responsibly. But otherwise, I think there is no stopping, to be honest with you. That's how we see it.
Okay. You are also investor in some of the companies. Just trying to an investor's point of view, how do you know that this is a company that one should invest in? And how do you see the green signals?
So there are two types of investments. One is strategic, basically, which are more aligned to the businesses that we do. And the other is more you do as an investor. So the first category, definitely you need to see that what synergies are there, and then eventually can that be acquired, folded up or merged or whatsoever. So there the view we take on opportunities is very different. Build versus partner buy kind of approach is what drives our decisions. The second is when we look at our investor, I think the key thing is, of course, the founders. And most importantly, I will say, other than the founders, is the governance. And unless until we see that there is some institutional investor or somebody who is going to devote a good amount of time to drive the hygiene companies over there. As a minority shareholder in India, without a good check on governance, it is very difficult to see that any money that you put in will eventually see the light of the day. So governance is a very, very important thing other than the founder. These are the two things I will say that drives a lot of our decisions. Yeah.
Okay. I'd also like to hear your perspective on the impact of startups on our country. So just a background to this question. India comes from a very socialistic kind of mindset, and entrepreneurship and startups, they are capitalistic ball games. How do you see India in next 10 years time, where it is going as a society and as a country in terms of embracing the capitalism culture?
So let me start with the society first. So if you see, there is a sea change in the attitude of the society. Like, I will give my personal example. When we started, it took me almost 3 years to explain to my parents that what am I doing? When I was getting married, mine is an arranged marriage. So even if you go and marriage is a big thing in the Indian society for some reason, I don't know why, but still it's a big issue, right? So you see the perspective was so different. People were a lot more comfortable with somebody in a 9-to-6 job, earning even 100th of the money that we were possibly making, rather than looking at an entrepreneurship. But today you see entrepreneurship is so much idolized and adored. So I think the social acceptance for entrepreneurship is very, very high. Sometimes it is become a lot more fashionable, actually, even though people might not be doing anything, but people want to say that they are entrepreneurs, right? So we have to be careful on that aspect. If I talk about the government and if you talk to senior bureaucrats, I see a sea change in their attitude. Most of them are very, very pro outsourcing. They know the limitations, and today they are not getting bedazzled by only the big names. Most of the seasoned bureaucrats know that there are enough good startups who are solving real issues, and they're very, very enthusiastic about encouraging, promoting them. So from that point of view, the bureaucracy is definitely getting a lot more aligned, especially the younger bureaucrats. I'm seeing that receptiveness is there. And same thing applies to politicians also. So that change definitely is there, where that of course, from a political narrative point of view, socialism, Aam Aadmi and all that, they will continue talking, but But if you talk to them on a one-on-one, I think there is a lot of regard for entrepreneurs. And the sense that the kind of impact and the problems they can solve, it is very difficult for them to solve just on their own. So I think the approach is very collaborative, harmonious, participative. There is no confrontation, I see. And I think maybe in next 5 years, whatever left of socialism is there, that also should go over there.
Okay. Now coming to the personal side of being an entrepreneur. So as an entrepreneur, you are required to stay energetic and consistent most of the times, at least more than what a common man would do. Sometimes you may feel tired, restless, and lose the focus as well. And when that happens, your business might also suffer because you are leading a complete unit. How do you manage such situations? And more importantly, how do you stay consistent?
So, see, and this is a line which my mentor Ashish Gupta told us back, that most entrepreneurs at one level are schizophrenic. So at one end, they will be completely paranoid and say nothing is working out when they are on their own, talking to themselves or the very key people. And then when they go out to their employees and all they will say all is well, kind of a thing. And they very seamlessly shift between these two personalities all the time. And another example you can pick up is this Stockdale syndrome. Which is during the Vietnam War, he was the highest ranking American admiral who was basically put in confinement by the Vietnamese. So the way he solves it, that at one end, he has a full belief that we will get out. So entrepreneur is someone who has the belief that I will get through, I will get past this problem. At the same time, when entrepreneur is attempting to solve the problem, he is absolutely paranoid. That as if he or she will die if they are not able to solve it. So I think when it comes to execution, solving things, you have to show that kind of paranoia. At the same time, you have to be calm enough to be able to have that faith. In Hindi, it is said that itni shakti dena data ki man ka vishwas ho. I think that's a key thing. Man ka vishwas is a key thing. That should not get dissipated anywhere. Rest, I think, is very easy to handle, and there also I believe that it is very important to have co-founders or have friends in the organization, not just employees. I can tell you personally, I am blessed. I have a couple of my batchmates who are friends. They are not batchmates, and they are lifetime friends, companions. So the amount of things that you can confess with them, talk to them, I think that is very important in an entrepreneurship journey. Those friends or colleagues are absolutely priceless, and all of us should cherish them and treat them with much more respect than we treat ourselves over there. So if one does that, I think it's something which can be easily managed.
Okay. A big part of entrepreneur's life go towards making decisions, and when you make decisions, it impacts a lot of people's lives. Can you tell us what is the process of decision making that you follow when taking tough decisions?
So here I will say that, see, as businesses grow, the complexity increases. So and most entrepreneurs are jack of all. Typically, we are not master of none, I will not say, but master of maybe one kind of a thing. But we are jack of all. So what I have personally realized is that as business grows, whether it is HR decisions, finance decisions, and all that, the complexity is huge. Now, when you have to handle that level of complexity, the key issue is understanding the phenomena, understanding the science behind it. So a lot of times as entrepreneurs, we get caught into being unable to understand the science behind it, why it is happening, kind of a thing. And that is where I think that role of functional experts, the role of board, the role of mentors come in. Typically, and they it's like basically a king has to have a very good a wazir or the panel of ministers, right? Basically, and they advise the king that okay, if you do this, this will happen. If you do this, this will happen. The decision is of the king, right? Entrepreneur is a lot like that. As you grow, you need to appreciate that what kind of things are going to become a lot more complex. Which will be beyond our comprehension. And you keep bringing experts for those aspects and allow them to deconstruct, take their advice, and then multiplex it with many other factors and then take a decision so that the decision becomes a lot more informed over there. That's what personally I try to in areas where I believe that it is beyond my understanding and ability. And that has worked well for us.
When you make decisions, some of those decisions also end up becoming a failure. Can you tell us about some of the instances where you have failed as an entrepreneur?
So there are a good number of instances where we have failed as an entrepreneur, typically, because entrepreneurship is a lot about the Brahma and the Shiva. So if you keep doing only Brahma, then there is a problem. So you need to also do Shiva to destroy if something is not working out. So I remember we made one strategic investment, and then we realized that the company had a lot of governance issues. So that was a mistake in the hindsight, that we should have been a lot more particular about governance than what possibly we did over there. The other areas have been hiring some people at senior levels, typically. And they were excellent people, but possibly we were not ready for that. So sometimes you over hire, basically, very senior folks, and the organization doesn't have that level of maturity, the abstraction that those people expect to be provided. So you go more by their experience and profiles. So we made a couple of mistakes on that side without creating the so-called hygiene, the abstraction. We just hired them and thought that things will work out. They did not go as planned. So those are some of the places where we see that we have gone wrong. We have not raised a lot of money and all, so I can't say that we terribly gooped up with money. But yes, with people, definitely, and then this funding and all is where we, yeah.
Okay. Speaking of hiring, and you hire for your company and as well as for other companies as well. Can you tell us which kind of people are most suitable for a startup environment?
So, see, this keeps evolving. When you start a business, obviously, you cannot hire anybody who is very experienced, been there, done it kind of people. Neither you need it, neither you can afford them, neither they are going to come to you. So it starts with basically mostly friends and acquaintances, where your personal brand equity matters more than anything else. And people come join you because of that. And then as you start growing, depending upon your business growth, your capital requirements, risk, and all of that, is where you start basically raising the bar, typically, because you can't be choosers in the beginning. And that's where you start bringing in people. So you start taking external help from companies like CareerNet, Longhouse, or Executive Search Brand, and do that. And then once you do that, obviously, sometimes you have to make hard decisions, because what has brought you from 0 to 1 may not take you from 1 to 10. Mm-hmm. So you need to be very clear with people that what person you have on the team who can take you from 0 to 1, 1 to 10, and 10 to 100. All these three are very, very different kinds of scale-ups. So what will work for, rarely you will see that people will fit into everything kind of a situation. So that's one thing to look for. The other thing is that I always say this, that aptitude is becoming a commodity and attitude is becoming a rarity. So I told you that 50 plus people who have been with us for more than 15 years, you'll be surprised. A good number of these people do not even have the offer letters, the first offer letters. And there are people where in last 15, 20, I never have done even one compensation discussion with them. Good times, bad times, I've never discussed salaries with them. I can't imagine this to happen any longer. That sense of gratitude, that sense of mutual respect and all that is on a decline in a big way. So I think that's the biggest casualty. The attitude is the biggest casualty today, which is very, very difficult to see. So I always try to hire people whom we believe are humble and good human beings, rather than being the most competent guy. Competent and arrogant is something which I have seen for us has not worked out. that category. Still, people, if they are slightly less competent, but they are humble, I think that category of people are much better in the long run. Sometimes you have to put a bull in the China shop, so that's okay. You may have some bad boys on the team because you need somebody to come and disrupt things. So once in a while, it's okay, but you cannot have too many of those people on your team. It is to be looked into. The other is that it has become more like Moore's law, that average tenure of people in a company is reducing. I 20 years back, 15 years back, if people do not have a stay of at least 3 years in a company, we never used to even look at this.
True.
Today, when we look at a guy with 10-year experience, 7 jobs, I'm telling you honestly, we try convincing ourselves that why should we meet? Oh, this company may have closed down, this company may have got merged. We justify to ourselves that why are we meeting this candidate? So I think that is one aspect which all entrepreneurs and all managers have to reconcile with, that jobs are becoming more of assignments than basically more of a career opportunity or whatever has to be put in. So we are dealing with a very different expectation talent today. So we need to basically be very, very clear on that. And it's a big change for a lot of people who have tried to create organizations. See, the big problem I see today is that the big casualty in entrepreneurship is that very few of us are trying to create organizations. We are trying to create success stories. And everybody here is for an exit. And I always continue to believe that the best companies are bought, they are never sold. So somewhere that is reflecting in the talent's attitude today as well.
That is so true. Coming to the next question, how would you define the term entrepreneur, or what is the meaning of the meaning of entrepreneurship to you?
So I may not be able to quote it in a right way, but one very good line I liked, which I listened to Manish Sabharwal once. So Manish said that entrepreneurship is the art of staying put till the time you get lucky. So I think entrepreneurship is one person, who should stand the course. You have to be there for the long haul. And in between, whatever you believe in, your hypothesis is there, you will get the opportunity. So the question is that, can you stay the course? Can you pivot your business whatsoever and all of that? But if you can withstand the course, you will get lucky sometime, and that is good enough as a reward for whatever you set out for yourself to start off.
Okay. The final question from my side, tell us about the interesting lessons that you have learned as an entrepreneur, which we can take away and apply to our venture.
So, that's a tough one. So one big lesson is that stay the course. I think get into entrepreneurship for the long haul. Your drivers have to be very different from valuation, money, fame, any of that. Like I sometimes give this example to people. When you look at in our time, 20 years back, a lot of people used to write civil services exams. The people continue to write today, but of course in IITs and all, that number has gone down today. People used to stay in GSRI for 3, 4 years. Their colleagues go to US, will be doing so well and all of that. But so I see that the intense desire that they had to get into civil services, I can't think of it. They know that they have a cozy job, which they can pick up anytime. But they were foregoing that and pursuing that dream. So I think somewhere entrepreneurship is a lot about, like, I've seen that intensity. What is the intensity of your passion is very, very important, and that has held good. The other thing is try to do basically more with less. Frugality is very, very, very important. And not only in the personal lives, but in every aspect of the business. Sometimes these days when I see that people raise a lot of money, burning money on your business model is a fine thing. But suddenly you coming and saying that I need a very swanky office right, and all of that, as if you have arrived in life. Like I always tell, when a young entrepreneurs come to us asking for office, I always say that please treat this office as our office, not the office. 5 years down the line, you can think about your the office. Is something that is there. Third thing I will say that people are generating a lot of wealth today, but it takes time to stabilize the wealth. I remember a couple of weeks back, I was reading Mr. Ashok Soota, Happiest Minds founder, one somebody whom I really, really respect a lot. Somebody asked him that, when do you see a lot of younger entrepreneurs will start doing charity? So he gave a very nice answer. He said that let's not rush up on that. A lot of the entrepreneurs today who are generating wealth, let that wealth stabilize. It takes 10, 15 years for the wealth to stabilize. Where I stay in Adarsh Palm Retreat in Bangalore, and when I see people around, a lot of people who have got good exits, I think they still are will take their own sweet time for wealth to stabilize, which is very, very important. Because a lot of people, if you ask me, have taken a big hit on their personal lives. I see the big casualty of entrepreneurship in India, unfortunately, has been a loss of personal lives, typically. People not living together and all that. So I definitely say that one should not be an entrepreneur at the cost of personal life. You should have a great personal life because success beyond that has no meaning, typically, right? I remember one being told by a very close person that one founder who had almost $500 million exit, right? He went into depression. Now, how do you justify somebody having $500 million personal exit and going into depression? So nothing should be done beyond a point at the cost of personal life. These are few things which I believe are my takeaways as an entrepreneur. Consistency, sustainability, and something if you can create enduring, I think is what one should aim for during this journey.
Well, I think it was a beautiful session, and the answers were spot on. Lot of learnings. I think 20 plus years of entrepreneur journey came with a lot of learning, and we could hear some of it today. Lot of clarity in the thoughts. Thanks for your time, Rishi, and our best wishes for Indico and all the future ventures that you'll build.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Ravi. Yeah, thank you, Priya. Yeah, thank you, Priya. Yeah, thank you.